And MLMs, like, the stakes aren't as high in the sense that, you know, they're not selling eternal salvation, but they are selling a form of salvation because, again, they're finding these vulnerable people who want to feel more empowered or want to earn more money or want more of a community, and they're selling them this dream that, you know, evidence doesn't support really being possible.
Zelf.
On the shelf.
Guys, I've been on such a deep dive of anti-MLM YouTube videos for this past week, and it's just got to the point where I'm like, I have to make a video about this. I know this is not new to most of you who have been in Mormonism and who know anything about MLMs, but the similarities between MLMs and Mormonism are quite striking. It's also no secret that Mormonism and MLMs have a lot of overlap in terms of the people who are involved in them. And not just Mormons. From the deep dive I've been doing the last week, it seems like Christian housewives, you know, these women that are not educated or don't have careers and are stay-at-home moms, are the most susceptible to joining MLMs, pyramid schemes, legal pyramid schemes. And so yeah, I just thought it would be interesting to have a little chat about it today. So I made a list from watching all these videos of similarities between Mormonism and MLMs. And the first big obvious one is that for both Mormonism and MLMs, the evidence of their claims not being true is so overwhelming, it really makes you, you know, think, how does anyone believe this? And, you know, those of us who have been Mormon know how people believe it. But it really is just one of those things where there's no dispute. Like, 1% of people make money in MLMs. 99% of people who join MLMs don't make any money, and that's because the whole model, the recruitment model, like, you don't make money through selling products really in an MLM. You make it through recruiting people, and then it's basically a system where the employee is the customer. You know, these people that are selling the products are also the people buying the products. You know, it's a closed market, I think they call it. I'm gonna link this YouTube channel that I really like. What's it called? Oh, she's called Kiki Chanel. She makes a lot of good anti-MLM videos. I've been just binge watching all her stuff this week. But yeah, it's one of those things where it's like, how has someone like not Googled this enough to know that you're not gonna make money with an MLM? Like, I mean, I guess unless you think you're gonna be the 1%, whatever. It seems like both of these things rely on blind naivety. Like, they rely on ignorance, because if people knew 99% of people that join MLMs never make money, they obviously wouldn't join. And, you know, if I would have known at 16 that Joseph Smith married all these teenage girls and other men's wives and that the church was horrifically racist for a century and a half, I wouldn't have joined, right? They're both things where people joining don't really know what they're getting into. You know, they sort of pitch it as this wonderful thing and they sell it to you as the answer to all your problems. So, similarities between Mormonism and MLMs that I wrote down on my list while watching all these videos. I'm talking about MLMs in general because even though, you know, depending on the MLM, there'll be maybe a slightly different culture, slightly different practices, essentially they're all the same, you know. So, 100% lumping them together for this video. You're love bombed initially. When I joined the Mormon church, you just receive such an outpouring of love and support from members, and it's like, wow, I like don't remember the last time someone was this nice to me or this interested in me, or, you know, that kind of thing. From what I've seen, it's very similar with MLMs, where, you know, obviously a lot of people that are vulnerable to joining MLMs, as with Mormonism, are vulnerable people, kind of down on their luck. You don't see people who are in this amazing place in life joining Mormonism or MLMs, really. It's vulnerable people. They get this woman sliding into their inbox, you know, taking an interest in their life. Maybe it's someone from high school, an old friend, or maybe just a stranger. But like, for a lot of people who are lonely, that interest in them is intoxicating, is really appealing because they're lonely. Like, that's how it works. And again, Mormonism, MLMs both really rely on community to reel people in. So with MLMs, it's a very tribal sort of thing. Like, your team is very cohesive and very like always interacting and supporting each other, but it's a very sort of toxic form of community, because if you leave the community, if you leave an MLM, from what I've seen, it's just like with Mormonism, like, they will vilify dissenters. So one thing I heard one woman say, what was the MLM? I don't even remember, they're all the fucking same. But one thing one woman said, she was very high up in her MLM, like, you know, one of the 1% that did make a lot of money. She said when she left, friends that she'd had for years, you know, unfriended her on Facebook, blocked her, She got these really like hateful, essentially cyberbullying messages from people in the MLM saying like, you're spreading hate, and you know, everyone who is critical of an MLM is called a hater, or you know, they're spreading negativity. Very similar to what we see with Mormonism, right? If you leave Mormonism, if you question the validity of its claims or anything like that, you are, you know, told that you're negative, apostate, you don't have the spirit. And a common sentiment apparently among people in MLMs is that, oh, people who leave and who are critical, they're just bitter because they didn't work hard enough, or they didn't do this thing right, or you know, it's always basically your fault if you have a problem with an MLM. But why is her chin so wet? Oh, it's been drinking water. So another similarity that ties in with that is that in an MLM, if you do poorly, if you're not getting the results that you were promised by, you know, the person who slid into your inbox with a hey han message and, you know, said, you can just spend an hour a day, like whatever you've got, you know, they pitch it to you as very easy. Again, not telling you up front what joining this thing actually entails, because it, you know, to really make money in an MLM, you've got to be working 24/7, but even working 24/7 isn't going to guarantee that you're going to make money, because people just don't make money in MLMs. They spend money and make the company money. But yeah, so in Mormonism and with MLMs, if something's going wrong for you, if you have a criticism, it's your fault. You didn't try hard enough. You know, in Mormonism, it's like you wanted to sin, but then in an MLM, it's like you just couldn't stop watching Netflix. Whatever it is, it's that idea that you're lazy, you did something wrong, it's your fault. But if something goes well for you in an MLM, it's all sort of delivered through this lens of like, wow, how amazing is this company for giving me this opportunity? You know, so it's kind of that whole give credit to the organization for all your successes and put blame on yourself for all your failures. Even though it's, again, like Mormonism is not true. So when people start questioning, why does this thing not add up or whatever, it's because it's not true, but of course the rhetoric in the church is like not that, you know. So dishonesty is a big part of conversion with both Mormonism and MLMs, because like I said, they don't tell you all the stuff up front. The girl whose videos I've been watching, Kiki Chanel, she gets all these videos of team calls in MLM. So it's like people that have joined and it's their team talking amongst themselves. So it's like a more sort of insular form of speech, as opposed to like the public posts about how great the MLM is. And it's just crazy because these MLMs are sold to people as like, yeah, like if you've just got like a few spare hours a week, like make money from your phone on the couch, it's easy. But then when they're in these meetings, the leaders are like, you need to be constantly working 24/7, and they like bully these poor people into, you know, feeling so shit about themselves, because like sliding into people's DMs, like trying to get them to join a MLM doesn't work. So, you know, once you've exhausted your list of family and friends that you can pester to try and get them to join your MLM, that's kind of what you're left doing, like cold messaging these people. And it's just not a very effective strategy. So in these team calls, these MLM leaders will be so aggressive and so shamey towards these people for not getting the results. And they all pitch it through this lens of like, me being here on this team call, you know, the leader, is me doing you guys a service. But it's like, no, these people are making money for you. Like, you're their upline. Everything they make, you get a big cut off. So you're not doing a service. But anyway, it's kind of like in Mormonism. It's like people see the leaders as just doing this selfless service. But it's like the apostles get like six-figure salaries for being apostles and all their expenses covered. I mean, not even just apostles, you know, like mission presidents. The perks of being a mission president are insane. And then on top of that, obviously, there's all the social rewards that you get. You know, you're sort of deified in Mormonism for being an apostle or whatever. Not even an apostle. Again, just like a regular-ass bishop is like really revered by a lot of people. So there is that like social reward that you get. Not to say that there aren't Mormon leaders who are more selfless and sort of do engage in service from a more selfless place, but I think to just paint it as like, oh, these people are just being so selfless in their service, it's just not really true. You know, it's like even with missions, like you're expected to go, you're told to do it to get a hot wife, to get blessings. Like with everything in Mormonism, it's to get blessings. So another thing is unquestioning faith in the product. And so in Mormonism, that's obviously the gospel, whatever that means, because it's always changed. And then in MLMs, it's whatever product they're, you know, giving an insane markup so that they can make money through an MLM style business model. But yeah, you don't question the product. So I saw one video, actually Vice, oh, that's some cats eating plants. We've already had one throw up incident today. So Vice did a really good documentary on YouTube, I'll link that in the description box as well, about LuLaRoe, which is a Mormon-owned MLM, no surprise. And basically in LuLaRoe, they grew so fast that their warehouses like couldn't handle all the stock, and so there was a bunch of situations where like stock was getting left out in the rain outside the warehouse, and then people, these like LuLaRoe distributors were receiving the LuLaRoe clothes like really damp, or like some of them were like moldy or just really gross. And it was one of those things where like they weren't allowed to talk about it or post about it, or do you know what I mean? It was just like they were sort of just bullied into silence, because it's like we can't say anything negative about the product. And it's kind of like that with Mormonism. Like I remember feeling like, you know, if I couldn't ever post anything less than wonderful about the church online, even if it was like wanting to sort of start a conversation with other members, because, you know, heaven forbid it be bad PR. MLMs definitely have a culture of toxic positivity, even though, again, like you watch these team calls and it's so negative and so shameful and they're so like mean to the people in their downline. So, I mean, it's not actually positivity, it is just like delusion and not speaking negatively about the company or the product, because MLMs, like Mormonism, are built on a house of cards, because, you know, if everyone found out that 99% of people don't make money, chances are a lot less people would join. Or, you know, if people really kind of saw how the sausage gets made, probably wouldn't join, right? So as I said before, MLMs are very tribal in nature, and so you, that's one of the things that draws people to them, is this community of usually women who have their back, even though it's like if you leave, they don't have your back. They'll block you so fast, they'll unfriend you so fast. And you know, it's all through the lens of selling to people. So how, you know, how genuine is that relationship? Obviously not very most of the time. And it's the same with Mormonism. Like I left Mormonism and I had people that I loved and had been friends with for years unfriend me on Facebook, or like send me unkind messages that were like so blatantly unsupportive, not wanting to hear about, you know, my experience or anything like that, which is not true friendship, it's not true connection. If your relationship with another person, be it family, friend, lover, whatever, depends on you maintaining this one specific belief in an organization, then it isn't a true relationship. It's not a relationship that's built on genuine love and, you know, compassion and care for the other person, because, you know, it's all just so tied up in that organization, and you're not able to honor each other's experiences in the way that you should be able to in a healthy relationship. You see it all the time in Mormonism, people's families cut them off or suddenly have this horrible opinion of them, and, you know, Mormonism, when people leave, it tears apart so many relationships because they vilify dissenters, and so there's no real space for those relationships. And family in Mormonism gets so intertwined with the church that it's like Mormons don't know how to sort of have healthy family relationships without it. They've only ever seen it through that lens, and so to leave Mormonism is almost like to leave the family, and obviously there is that actual belief in eternal family, so they really do think that. So it's just a hot mess. And MLMs, like, the stakes aren't as high in the sense that, you know, they're not selling eternal salvation, but they are selling a form of salvation, because again, they're finding these vulnerable people who want to feel more empowered or want to earn more money or want more of a community, and they're selling them this dream that, you know, evidence doesn't support really being possible in 99% of cases. And also, by the way, from this woman who was in the top 1% of an MLM, she said it's miserable at the top. Like, everyone's so stressed all the time because it's just, again, it's just a whole shit show, and it's not just like this chill job. It's horrible. It's constant work. MLMs, like Mormonism, are selling a form of salvation, because it's like, we're gonna ease your loneliness, money issues, or, you know, all this stuff. We're gonna give you a sense of purpose. And so to question the MLM you're a part of, or MLMs, whatever, as a concept, is like to question that salvation. And who wants to question the dream of salvation they've been sold? Like, that's why it's so hard to leave the church, because to get comprehend that you know, believed you would have this certain afterlife and all this stuff, and then to be like, oh, that's just not true, but I've, like, my brain has, like, formed around that for so many years. Like, it's just such a tough thing. Like, our brains aren't good at getting away from stuff like that. Like, we want to cling to that, you know, delusion of salvation. And because MLMs and Mormonism are selling salvation, it means that people in those organizations are willing to sacrifice their own needs for the good of the organization, because they're told that loyalty to the organization is how you obtain that salvation. So like I said, this woman that made a video. I actually linked it in our community tab, so you guys might have already seen it, but if not, I'll link it in the description box to this. This woman that was at the top of one of these MLMs said that every single person in the MLM at the top was completely frenzied and stressed all the time, and they went on this fun retreat and nobody could do anything except lie around because they were just so exhausted and people would just have these breakdowns. Kind of reminds me of missionary service, you know, just that constant sacrificing your own needs for the good of the organization in a way that's really not healthy. And then in that same vein, everything is about the organization. We all know LDS people on social media who make everything in their life about Mormonism, because how could they not, you know? Anything happens to them and it's an opportunity to talk about Mormonism, to say how grateful you are, or how, you know, whatever it is, it penetrates every single area of your life. And it's the same with these MLMs. Like, people that are, you know, MLM accounts on social media are constantly posting, like, Instagram storying almost like all just every hour of the day, essentially, and everything is just so public because they need to be constantly selling. And I feel like it's like that with Mormonism for a lot of people as well. They feel the need to constantly be selling Mormonism because they've been told that that's part of reaching salvation, is spreading it to other people. And so, you know, with both, the missionary work model is obviously so similar, except it's not missionary work because, you know, there's a goal. The LDS church is getting 10% of people's incomes, and then the individual spreading the message is getting blessings and, you know, the social rewards of saying that you converted someone. I observed some similarities between team calls and what I've heard zone meetings and stuff alike on missions. So just that, like, obsessive focus on numbers. I don't know if it's like that anymore, but, you know, all the people I know who went on missions, it was very much like that. In Mormonism, you're supposed to do 10 Book of Mormon invitations a day or whatever it is on a mission, and it's the same with an MLM. It's like you're supposed to do these power hours where you send out 100 cold messages to people, and yeah, it's just that, like, relentless trying to push this thing on people and just going for a total numbers game. So yeah, a lot of interesting ties there. I feel like that could be its own video. But yeah, we all know that Mormon boys often come back from missions and go into sales for obvious reasons. They're good salesmen after spending 2 years of their life selling something that's not true. So yeah, everything in MLMs and Mormonism is often about the organization. And then a kind of a final point is that the product that they're each selling, so obviously Mormonism, it's salvation, or, you know, whatever you want to call it, the gospel, and then with MLMs, it's whatever product. But both of them are selling things that you can get elsewhere without anywhere near as high of a markup. So obviously in MLMs, that point is obvious, you know, they're selling stuff that you can find a ton of other places for way less, because it's just the business model depends on stuff being really heavily marked up. But then they have to have this cult-like thinking about the product to convince you that, no, this is different somehow, and it's, like, not actually different in any, like, verifiable way. You're just supposed to believe it is. And then with Mormonism, something that a lot of ex-Mormons say is that what is unique about Mormonism is not good, and what is good is not unique. So, you know, being kind to people or being close to your family, me and Tam just did a whole video about why that's bullshit, but, you know, all these good ideals that are promoted in Mormonism, depending on how you look at it, can obviously be found elsewhere. There's nothing about Mormonism that is unique and good, because, like, Joseph Smith was a con man who, there's, you know, polygamy, racism, homophobia, all that stuff. Like, you can get so many better messages of how to be a good person from Buddhists, or, you know, even other religions. Buddhism I don't really see as a religion, but, like, there's so many places you can get messages of, you know, being kind, serving others, all that stuff. Like, you don't need to be Mormon to get it. But that's just how it's pitched to, you know, people in it think that you can't get it anywhere else. And it's like, you absolutely can. Also, both MLMs and Mormonism do these big conferences every year. Well, twice a year with Mormonism, to, like, get people hyped. And I just thought that was a funny parallel as well. Like, these big indoctrination conferences that they obviously do in Scientology and other places as well. So the crux of the issue that I thought was so interesting is why Mormons are so prone to joining MLMs. And I think it goes deeper than just, I mean, women, especially stay-at-home mums, are especially vulnerable to joining MLMs, so that obviously is a big part of it. But I also think it is essentially just Mormons are raised to think through this lens of feelings over facts, you know? My feelings trump your facts. And that's obviously the case because the facts don't support Mormonism. Mormonism's truth claims are verifiably false. The Book of Mormon is not a historical record. The papyri that Joseph Smith said he translated the Book of Abraham from, Egyptologists have now translated since finding the Rosetta Stone post-Joseph Smith times, and they have nothing to do with anything Joseph Smith wrote. Joseph Smith translated fake Kinderhook plates, and then the church heralded them as an inspired translation for all this time, and then the Smithsonian, or whoever it was, the Chicago Historical Institute, some historical organization was like, these are a 19th century creation, they're not real. So Mormonism's truth claims, not true, like that, the evidence is more than stacked against it. But that's not what matters, because they're taught a method of determining the validity of something that is skewed, you know, because people in every religion around the world, or most religions, can get the burning in the bosom, can feel that they know that their religion is true, and those are all just like normal human phenomena that can happen with our brain. Like, our brains are wired to protect our deeply held beliefs at all costs. The sort of tribal nature of religion can give you those like oxytocin boosts that people will interpret as the spirit, and all kinds of stuff. Again, we have videos on that as well. Feelings over facts, like that's the business model of both of them. Just as like a little end story, I once got approached by this woman who sold doTERRA. I was a copywriting intern at the time, but also, you know, open to doing freelance copywriting work. And she reached out to me saying she wanted a copywriter for her doTERRA business. And I was like, oh, okay, well that's fine. Because it's like she wanted to do a website with blog posts about the different essential oils. And so I went to her house to meet with her, and then this other guy was there who was also, I think they were both doTERRA people, and they were just like so aggressively selling doTERRA to me. But I wasn't like there to, you know, I wasn't interested in becoming a doTERRA seller or anything, but they were really trying to convince me to become one, even though they sort of brought me there under the pretenses of like, we're looking for a copywriter for this website. But then, I don't know, it was just all such bullshit. But I remember at the time I was very Mormon, and I remember thinking, because I've always sort of been into sort of holistic health and stuff, but at the time I didn't know enough to know that like essential oils are pretty bullshit. But yeah, I remember like feeling the spirit in this exchange with these people, because they were using, you know, the same tactics on you that missionaries use, essentially, unknowingly probably. And I remember thinking that like the spirit was telling me that I should do doTERRA, which is absurd, right? But it just highlights like how similar, you know, both things operate. So I was able to use, you know, these preconceived notions I had that Mormonism was true to then back up this other thing that was also bullshit. I also had another experience where another Mormon mum, like, kind of like low-key scammed me into joining an MLM accidentally. That's a whole story. But yeah, I would love to hear your stories about MLMs and Mormonism, like your thoughts, your experiences. This has just been a pretty chatty video. I just wanted to talk about the subject because I've been watching so many videos. My camera battery's dying, what else is new? Thank you to our patrons for supporting us. If you want to support us on Patreon, I'll put a link in the description box. I hate this battery situation. Hope you're all doing well, and I'll see you soon.